John Chisholm. That's my story. Would start back at the very beginning. You know, first, we can go all the way back to the first before the few days, first few days of the GA at the at JFK. We can go as far as back as that. I mean, in the chat rooms beginning, it's insane to see this movement grow in Dallas from what it did, which is literally just a few people talking in a chat room, growing into like Facebook growing bigger and bigger and bigger, and the Twitter growing bigger and bigger and bigger, the first few three GAs, and then the first day where we had 1,000 people, the first occupation at JFK, where the police came in with big cameras and they recorded the whole thing. And we moved to Pioneer Plaza and it rained for the first time. It rained heavy for the first time in a long time. You can probably go check the records. I don't know how long before it hadn't rained, but I just remember that we hadn't had rain in a long time, and it was pouring. They thought that was going to make us leave, but of course we stuck around. The camp got torn down. Heavy, heavy winds, the media tent and medical tents, all those got just torn down repeatedly. But every time they got rebuilt, they even got rebuilt better. We had people come in that were ex-military, and they built very good tents for us. When we moved to the third camp, the first time they weren't even as good as the, you know, the last time at Pioneer. We started losing people who did that got tired of doing it over and over again. And I don't know what happened, but it's kind of a reflection of how our objective or how our vision faded of what we were supposed to do as the camp kind of deteriorated in a way. It got worse and worse. In my opinion, it got worse and worse as we went. You know, the infighting got worse and worse. It was to the point where we had people splitting off to form their own separate camps. And it was reflected in just the general upkeep of the camp. I mean, there's a lot more I can reminisce about.
But since that's been 6 months ago, now we're 6, 8 months, 9 months later, has there been an evolution? What's the changes you've seen?
As far as just the general changes, I listen, you know, I've always listened to like things like NPR. I generally keep track of what's being talked about because I like, you know, that interests me. And it seems that we've brought a lot of these things into the public discussion, you know, which is a very positive thing. I think what we failed to do is engage the community in a way that would actually make them discuss to each other. I think the key to there being real change is the community is actually getting together, deciding what they want, and working together as a community. Because I think that's where our strength lies. As we learn from the occupation, as a community, we can do a lot and we can grow. But when we're not a community anymore, things just don't work out. And then we just fight a lot more if we lose that sense of community.
Now, can you create that sense of community on Facebook, Twitter, or GAs in the park?
I think you can start forming those bonds. I think it's a good way to get information out there. I think General Assemblies scare people at this point because I've been to some General Assemblies that they nearly ended in a riot. Sometimes when you say General Assembly, it has just this bad connotation in people's minds. I think if it was, you know, a community picnic to get together,
thank you,
come discuss, you know, their opinions and like, yeah, this is about politics, this is about what's happening in your world, but you need to talk with your community, you know, this is what we need to discuss things. If you don't agree with, you know, what the occupiers are saying, what the Tea Party's saying, then where do you stand?
Yeah.
If you don't agree with the Republicans, you don't agree with the Democrats, where are you? And what, you know, I'm sure you're not alone. Most people don't realize that they're not alone. I had one of the most mind-blowing experiences of the whole thing was the amount of support we got.
Yeah.
On the first day, we didn't have any water for the 1,000 people that were there. So me and a couple people, we went to Target and we got some money and we got some water and we brought it back. And by the time we got there, somebody else was dropping off water. From that point on, we didn't stop getting water. That first day, we got so much water, it pretty much lasted us the rest of the week, and we didn't stop getting water. We kept getting food. We had so much food that we were just having to tell people, no, eat this food, please, or it's going to go bad. We had to just ask people to eat food.
Yes, yes.
And, you know, that you can see how that kind of dwindled down. Even when the camp got shut down, we still had a massive supply of food, and, I mean, we had enough food to feed an army. I know that some of it got distributed out to houses, and, like, we got 10 pounds of it just at this house that I ended up staying at afterwards. And that guy ended up getting distributed across. So it's like, I guess it's also a good metaphor for how the occupation really ended in a way. It wasn't really, they didn't just disappear. Everybody kind of dispersed and they're spreading. And some people are bouncing around and everybody's pretty much moving right now. It's become more nomadic. And I think what we learn from there is going to help us in the future. I mean, I can't say, you know, exactly what's going to happen, but I believe all that happened for a reason. I believe that that will come into necessity again. You know, like that will be something that may need to happen again. And I think that knowledge that we gain from that kind of experience can be very valuable later on. And I think everybody who participated should remember, you know.
in the meantime, maybe what you guys should do is a potluck in the park.
Exactly, exactly. I agree. And I'm not going to say I haven't been involved, but it's kind of like the burnout after you spend the entire time you're there. And then afterwards, you're like, you know what? I'm just going to go live my life for a little bit. I just need a break for a while because I nearly went insane trying to, work myself to death with this. So I just need a break. And now I'm getting to that point where I really want to get more involved. And, I definitely will try to do my best in between work and trying to move and, my fiance, who I met at the occupation. I met my fiance through Occupy. I never would have met her. So that's crazy.
I've heard tell there are a lot of what they call Occupy romances.
Exactly. But it's
there's also a lot of networking. There's a labor unions kind of network with them. Yeah. Churches network with Occupy in this area anyway.
Exactly. There's a network. We've spread out and we've got this network. I know people in several different states that I can contact through Facebook or through the phone. And if I need to say, hey, I'm coming through there, I need somewhere to stay or I need resources. We have that ability. As occupiers, you gain this, kind of inherent ability to go around. And, you can meet other occupiers in other cities. Like, when we went to D.C., we really didn't have to worry too much about food because there was occupiers there. We had a place to go. And I think that was one of the big things about it. And I think that's one of the things that, came off of it in the end. It's kind of unseen by those who are outside of it.